Welcome everyone to episode number 5, 6, 900. I think it's number 5 of Headroom, coming to you here from the campus at iZotope in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And I'm joined here by, do you prefer to be called Alex or Alexey?
Whatever.
Doesn't matter. Alexey Lukin, it makes you sound more like a spy, I think. We're going to get to the meat of the program with Alexey here in a little bit, but just a few minutes of intro here. My name's Jonathan Weiner. I'm the education director here at iZotope. And Headroom is a program meant to kind of provide some interesting and educational information from a fairly high level about audio topics, although today we may dive a little bit into the weeds since we're lucky enough to have Alexey with us. You are invited to input questions via the chat tool, and there will be instructions that you should have already seen at the beginning of the webcast that'll tell you how to do that. Alexey and I will be online on the day of the airing to answer your questions live. And what else do I want to say? These episodes will be archived, and you'll be able to find them via the iZotope website in our community tab. Eventually, we will have a Headroom tab or something like it. And so stay tuned for that. And we'd also love it if you would fill in the survey that you'll be invited to fill in also via the chat tool. That helps us understand how much you're enjoying this, what we might do better, what you're interested in, and stuff like that. So thank you in advance for taking the time to do that. So I think I'm going to dive right in and just frame out today's topic. In general, we're going to be talking about audio repair and restoration, and AKA magic. And the reason that I put it that way is that to me, just as a practitioner, somebody who's been involved in audio production, the ability to take out distortion, noise, remove unwanted signals or repair signals from audio is like magic. And in my first encounter with audio repair technology was about 30 years ago, Sonic Solutions and Soundroid, their product that turned into a commercial product called No Noise, was the first thing that we had the ability to do this kind of single-ended repair with. Back then, I had no idea what was going on under the hood. It was just like magic. As I've learned more and more what's going on under the hood, it seems even more like magic to me, because ultimately the goal for us in using these tools is to be able to remove, to decrease the distance, if you will, or increase the contact between the audience and what we want them to hear. We're removing something that's distancing, whether it's in the context of an old recording, and we're trying to get the noise out of the way so they can hear the music or the sound, the spoken word, whatever it is, better. Or in the context of a new recording, if you have a vocal that might be clipped and the clip is going to distract the audience, and we can fix that kind of problem using these tools. And so for me, the magic is simply the fact that we can make the experience better for everybody. Today our goal is to spend a little time diving in and talking about specific techniques and strategies, and hopefully getting a better understanding of how to engage in noise, audio repair, noise removal, however we want to put it. In general, we try to stay sort of high level, but inevitably today we'll spend a little bit of time talking about RX, and RX6 just recently came out. So I'm sure some of the things that are in development and starting to show up in the tools will come into our conversation. So let's see. So I think that the first thing I'd like to do is spend a little bit of time looking at the way that we are able to visualize and view audio that ultimately will lead itself and lend itself to talking about some of the noise reduction tools and strategies for using them. And this may be familiar for some of you or all of you, and we promise to get into some more advanced thinking in a little bit. But, let me make sure that I'm actually recording the screen. But before we dive in, let's just get sort of a little primer on how to look at audio when you're working with a tool like RX. So if you take a look at the screen here, you'll see that there's a waveform that's being displayed, and it's something that probably everybody is familiar with. You have, in this case, it's a stereo recording. You've got two channels, left and right. You can see amplitude, you have time, and this kind of visualization, which is something that people are now very familiar with in the context of DAWs, is great at showing you something about energy over time, tells you something about level, amplitude of a signal. You can't really get a whole lot more information about it. You can't tell anything about frequency or anything about the nature of the things that you're hearing. And I want to say, whenever we're doing anything with audio, I guess I just want to say out loud, lead with your ears. You know, we hear something, we want to understand what we're hearing and maybe how to interact with it better, whether it's in using an equalizer or a compressor or a declipper. You hear something that leads you to want to figure out what the problem is and how to address it, so that the visualizations that we get are great for confirming and helping lead us to a processing step. But always we lead with our ears first. I don't think it's possible to mix a record just using visualizations, although... Yeah. Maybe some people would argue with me. I don't know. Anyway, so here you have the waveform. There's another way of viewing the information, and it's kind of interesting to just break this down and see what information you can get by looking at the spectral display of the information. And for anybody experienced with RX or any spectral editors, this is familiar, but for some of you it may not be. We're seeing the same information. We have channel number one, channel number two. We have time, which is left to right. But the idea of amplitude is expressed a little bit differently here. We have amplitude is expressed by intensity of color or light in the display, if you will. And frequency is what's showing up in the... Oh, thank you. I really appreciate that. Frequency is showing up in the x-axis, or the y-axis. Sorry.
Y-axis.
Yes, thank you. So here, if I were to just play this, you'll see and hear that these each express discrete notes and harmonics associated with them. So, is that a Mixolydian scale? I'm not sure. Anyway, so very quickly you can see, oh, I see the notes, I see they're ascending. I can see that some of them are louder than others. And isn't that interesting? And one of the things that's amazing to me about manipulating audio using a spectral display like this is that if you can get this much information this quickly, you can do some direct editing in the spectrum without getting into sort of fancy tools or sophisticated tools like a noise reducer and so on, and making adjustments. So if I could highlight this note and reduce the gain associated with that note, I could make this scale sound a little bit more even. And in fact, I can do that. And I can even go one step further, and instead of changing the gain on the entire spectrum, I can highlight the fundamental frequency of the note and simply push that fundamental frequency back a touch, say by 3 dB or something like that. And now it's a little bit more even, and I could raise this one and so on and so forth. And so you can get a sense of how you can do some interesting operations very quickly because of the nature of the visual feedback that we get from a spectral display. A couple of other things that you can do. Find a noise. Well, I don't know how well you'll be able to hear that out in YouTube land, but there's some rustling there, right? I can find it very easily with my eyes. I hear it, and now I can see it. If I wanted to replace that, not that this is necessarily recommended, but I could copy and I could paste, and I've taken clean ambience and reduced some of the noise just by a copy and paste operation. So again, it's the kind of thing that you can do just by having access to this kind of spectral display. I won't spend too much more time doing this, but one other thing I want to point out, which I think is kind of a neat application, is that you can use this spectral display to help you de-ess. It's very easy to see S's. That cloud of energy there represents an S. And I don't know if we'll spend time talking about the de-esser tool that's built into RX per se, but if you simply wanted to take high-frequency energy down and you can isolate the high-frequency energy this way, it's entirely possible to just grab a couple of S's and take out a little bit of the energy in the top end, and now I've done an effective and very fast job de-essing. And I'm not dealing with the artifacts that come along with deploying a traditional de-esser and so on. So there are many different things that I'm sure you all could think of to do just interacting with the audio directly in the spectral display like this. And if there are questions about that, feel free to ask them online, and we'll try to answer them the best that we can. So is there anything more that you'd like to sort of add to this sort of, you know, when we're looking at a display, maybe, or a spectral display, help us understand a little bit better what we're seeing and how we can change or manipulate what we're seeing, and maybe that will lead into conversations about some of the noise reduction work.
First of all, thank you for inviting me to join the episode.
I'm so pleased to have you here.
I'm very glad to be here, yeah. And you are completely right. Spectrogram presents much more information that's useful for analysis, repair, mixing, than the waveform does, because the spectrogram is closer to what our brain receives from the middle ear. There is an organ in the middle ear called cochlea, which decomposes the complex sound into more primary, individual, harmonically tuned bandpass filters. So spectrogram is closer to what the output of the middle ear is and how it's actually perceived by the brain. In the waveform, you can see how sound pressure changes with time, but unless you zoom in a lot, it's hard for you to analyze the signal. For example, in this recording, if you just look at the waveform, you can see the increase in pressure in the beginning and then decrease in levels and then four transients. But as you look at the spectrogram, you can actually see that the first part is more harmonic and the second part is more transient, and the harmonics are slowly decaying here in the guitar chord. And all of this isn't really visible very well in the waveform. What's more important for noise reduction is that in restoration or noise reduction, some types of contamination are not even visible on the waveform at all. And we will get to that in a few minutes. But Spectrogram is really important for detecting subtle changes in the signal or subtle problems with the signal, like very minor clicks or crackle that would not be even visible in the waveform. And of course, as you are navigating the spectrogram, it's important to understand the limitations of the spectrogram display and what's the precision of spectrogram in frequency and in time. Let me dive into that a little bit.
Great. And while you're doing that, while you're opening this, you know, I was completely remiss in not introducing you. It was very silly of me. And so Alexey Lukin is, I would say, the primary developer, mover and shaker behind iZotope RX. Let's just take a quick moment. So you are, you work for iZotope. I don't know what your title is here.
I'm the principal DSP engineer, which means I am developing algorithms that go into iZotope products, the mathematics of them. And I've been working on RX since the first version, and even before the first version. Actually, our work on RX has started in 2003, a few years before the first release in 2007.
Great. And so this is the authority from which you speak about these things. You also teach, do you not? You're a lecturer?
I used to. Mm-hmm. I taught the course, the introductory course in signal processing in Moscow State University, the one that I graduated from myself.
Great. Excellent. So anyway, just wanted to make sure people knew the gravitas here. So let's go forward. You were going to show us something about how we can change what we see that will help us see what we want to see better.
Right. Whenever you look at the spectrogram, the ability of the spectrogram to show you details in frequency and in time is limited by the so-called FFT size, or short time Fourier transform window size. If you go into spectrogram settings in the context menu of RX, you can see many options here. And to begin my journey, I will switch spectrogram to a mode that's more primitive and simpler, the one that you can see in other competing applications with spectrogram. And you can see this FFT size parameter being close to the top. It means that it's pretty important. Let me show you how FFT size affects the spectrogram. FFT size basically tells you in how many frequency bands you are splitting your signal before you display it on a screen. The higher the FFT size, the more frequency precision you get. If you have closely spaced harmonics, you might not be able to separate them or tell them apart if your frequency precision is not enough to put them in separate channels of the Fourier transform, and spectrogram will not resolve them. You can see that if I decrease the FFT size, the harmonics of the guitar, especially here at lower frequencies where they are more dense, will merge together. And as I decrease it even further, even higher harmonics here in the chord will blend together and you will not be able to see them. But at the same time, lower frequency precision, due to the principle of uncertainty, means better time precision. And the window that the fast Fourier transform uses shrinks in time. 128 samples here basically mean that you are using the window of 128 audio samples, which is just a couple of milliseconds at this sampling rate. And it's the precision in time that you can get. You can see that the transient here, the castanets, are more defined in time, sharper. And as I increase the FFT size, you can see that you get more precision in frequency. Those harmonics of the guitar are resolved better, but the castanets are starting to blur, and you cannot even precisely tell anymore where does the castanet begin. And the attacks of guitar notes and the chord are also smeared in time. That's called the principle of uncertainty. You cannot maximize frequency precision and time precision together at the same time. It's always a compromise. But in RX, we have some assistive tools to help you display the spectrogram that's more intuitive to use. So we have this special auto-adjustable mode. Let me go back to my original
settings. Can I ask you a question about this, just so I'm clear? Are you saying, so this is clearly about the visualization. Does it also influence the processing, what's happening under the hood? Or is that a separate?
In RX, it does not. In RX, you, in many processors, have a separate adjustment for FFT size. So you can control the number of bands in the processing separately from your visualization. But it could be linked. Mm-hmm. I'm going to back to my original settings. And the original setting here is called auto-adjustable short-time Fourier transform. It means that it will choose the FFT size automatically based on your zoom ratio, zoom factor. As you're zooming closer in time, you can see that the FFT size changes here so that you can see more details in time. The FFT size is decreased. For example, as I zoom closer here, you can see that the harmonics blend together into kind of clouds of noise or rumble. But as I zoom into frequency, you can see harmonics are becoming more distinct. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This is called auto-adjustable FFT size, and basically that's one of the features in RX that you are using, but you are not even realizing it's there. It just tries to give you the sharpest image.
Great.
Every time. And as we are speaking of the spectrogram, it's also important to understand that spectrogram is great, but some of the technical problems are also more easily spotted in the waveform. If you're speaking of things like clipping or clicks, some of them may be visible in the spectrogram, but you don't really know if you are looking at clipping or just distortion from the spectrogram. Waveform is also important. And that's why in RX, I usually start analyzing the signal by looking at the waveform and try to identify problems that could be visible in the waveform first before I dive into the spectrogram.
Interesting. And actually, that's going to tie in. I think we're going to spend some time talking about being strategic and where to start and how to think about signals. And so there's a first sort of thought about that. So I think it might be helpful to set a little bit of context for the strategic thinking that we do want to talk about by talking about the kinds of, what I want to get to is the difference between dealing with steady state signals or signals that have strong harmonic content. In other words, there's a longer time base for the issue that we're trying to address or the signal as opposed to short term problems. And more specifically, there are strategies that allow us to reduce broadband noise and sustained noises, and there are strategies that allow us to deal with short-term problems. And maybe to define them or talk about those a little bit, and then we'll dive into maybe a discussion about how it just doesn't matter anyway, because you know, sometimes an interpolator will work on a long-term signal and vice versa or something like that. So There are broadly speaking, two different classes of tools that we're using. One is something that's meant or designed to deal with unchanging steady state noise, hum, room tone, hiss, and so on. Do you want to just say a few words about that class of kind of denoiser?
Yeah, that's probably the oldest class of denoisers. Since 1940s, there existed units for gating noise in radio transmissions. They were called squelch devices, and basically they were a broadband gate that closed when the level of the signal went below the threshold and opened when the level was above the threshold. So it could be a fixed threshold device or an auto-addressable threshold device, but the gate or the expander, the gate with a soft knee, are all variants of what is now used as a denoiser. And as they evolved, there might be multiple variations on that, such as a multiband gate. And even today's denoisers that work in spectral domain, work with FFT, with a spectrogram, they could be described as a multiband gate still, but with hundreds and thousands of bands as opposed to one or five or seven bands of analog gates. It wasn't practical in the analog electronics to create a crossover or a gate with multiple bands, more than 10 bands. It just added distortion, phase distortion, amplitude, ripple too quickly. And now in digital electronics, it becomes possible with very low distortion and completely controllable kinds of artifacts.
Mm-hmm. So if you were to, you know, give us a few sentences about what kinds of problems this kind of tool is best at addressing. And I think some of them are pretty obvious, but...
Of course. The single best type of problems that could be addressed by denoisers are stationary noise. Stationary means that the noise properties do not change much in time. The power or the frequency distribution, the spectrum of the noise, doesn't change in time. In practice, such noises could be the noise from electronics, like preamp, mic preamp noise, or the air conditioner that doesn't turn on and off too frequently is, again, stationary noise. The refrigerator, other kinds of noises that do not change much in time. The noises that cannot be handled by such denoisers are usually the noises that vary quickly enough. Footsteps or cars passing by or any kind of impulse noises such as clicks, pops, mm-hmm. thumps, rumble.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about, so when, and this is, I think, I'm about to ask a question that I think a lot of people will have encountered, which is you start with a signature of an HVAC system, or an air conditioner or something like that, that starts at one level, and you recognize that 2 or 3 or 5 minutes later, it's at a different level, or something has changed about the way it's exciting the acoustic space and the harmonic content of it. So what kind of tool do you then, or what kind of strategy do you use in an instance like this? Does it disqualify the use of a broadband denoiser?
Not exactly, but you have to adjust to that. When the noise profile or the noise floor, the ambience, changes over time, you would either have to use the adaptive mode of the denoiser that kind of tracks the noise floor in real time. And many denoisers exist that adapt the noise floor in real time for speech. It's a little bit more difficult for music, because with speech, after every sentence, you have a small pause, and that's where you can sample noise profile from. But in music, it usually goes and on and on and on, and if the noise floor changes, mm-hmm. there isn't much space for you or pauses to sample it from. Mm-hmm. So for music, I usually try to not use the adaptive modes of the denoisers, but I always check results. If I see gain reduction in useful music, I will not use it. Another strategy here is that oftentimes I can apply some kind of sidechain compression or sidechain expansion to undo the changes in the noise floor. Sometimes changes in the noise floor also indicate the changes to the level of desirable signal, such as, for example, if the desirable signal containing the steady noise has been compressed, then the changes in the level of the desirable signal will also be in sync with noise floor changes. So by using the sidechain compression, I can put only a narrow band of noise in the sidechain, and then the compressor will react to changes in the noise floor and basically undo the compression that has been applied to the signal before, with a goal being to equalize the noise floor over time. And then if you want, you can undo this equalization of the noise floor over time by applying another sidechain compressor that operates on the output of the first compressor with a certain tricks to memorize how the first compressor worked. Basically, the goal here is to equalize the noise floor in time and then run the denoiser on the steady state noise. And then after that, you can undo your changes in dynamics if you want to, or maybe that were good changes in dynamics.
Right, right, fantastic. So if you want to know more about where that sidechain is coming from, you can ask a question about that in the chat. So let's go and move towards the sort of shorter time-based kinds of issue. And traditionally, until fairly recently, I think interpolation has been the kind of tool that we've used. So this is where we have an interruption in a signal, a click or a pop. It could even be something like a pencil dropping on a floor during a performance in a live recording, or a very short lip smack or something like that. So just walk us through a little bit about interpolation and interpolators.
Interpolation is a more recent advance in signal processing. It wasn't popular until, I would say, the digital electronics has taken over.
Well, it wasn't really possible, was it?
It wasn't really possible in analog world. You could probably hold the value of the analog signal maybe by sampling it or using delay lines for a little bit, so like a zero order hold type of interpolation would be possible in analog, maybe.
There was a device made by Berwyn called the transient noise eliminator that I think was entirely an analog domain device. It was meant to take out record crackle.
But... Interesting.
Yeah.
Maybe it was kind of a transient shaper, but probably it was some simple kind of interpolator. But definitely with digital electronics and with digital signal processing, we have much more power and capability of analyzing the signal in offline mode. We have look ahead to see whether some transient is actually quickly stopping and it's an impulse noise, or it's continuing as a decay and it's a drum hit. That kind of look ahead is very important in our algorithms to tell apart attacks of instruments like drums from impulse noises like vinyl crackle.
So let's see. I wonder if we can sort of give a quick visual demonstration of what interpolation seeks to do. This is not a good example for interpolation because that castanet is probably something that we'd want to retain.
Yeah. Maybe we can switch to clicks.wave here.
Oh, great. Perfect.
We have some minor clicks here, and it's a good example where you can actually not see clicks in the waveform. You would have to look at the spectrogram to see them. And clicks, because they are very short and localized in time, they are visible as vertical lines or vertical spikes on the spectrogram.
That's great. This is a great example. So here where we zoom in, now that we've zoomed in enough, we can begin to visually recognize the difference between a musical signal and a noisy signal.
Right. But it would probably take you hours and hours of scrolling through the waveform to actually find those small spikes.
That's correct. What I was hoping to just kind of clarify here is what the idea of interpolation is, which would be to be able to differentiate or make use of the known data here that's good before and after, and replace this with numbers, information that would be built on the information that's surrounding it. So we could interpolate just this, you know, this is 10 samples or something like that, and effectively remove that single click.
Yep, that's how pretty much every interpolation algorithm works. They first either manually, like you did, or automatically find the boundaries of the click, and they consider the surrounding signal as some kind of model of a good signal, and then they discard the click that was selected, and they will try to synthesize the replacement signal to fill in and blend smoothly with the surrounding according to the model of the surrounding signal. For example, in RX, we have this interpolate module that can repair a single click that was selected manually. If you run it, you can see that the waveform is now smoothly connected to the left and to the right. And if you zoom into waveform amplitude, you can see that there is a smooth repair. It can also capture more complex shapes or longer parts of the signal. If you make your selection a bit longer, it'll probably be able to repair that as well. Yeah, you can see that actually the repaired signal is pretty close to the original signal and the click is gone.
Excellent.
But many click reduction software are actually automatic. They find clicks in the waveform for you and they replace them pretty much like this interpolate mode does. But when you have a vinyl record or when clicks come very often, it might not be practical to find all of them by hand. So that's where automatic declickers and de-cracklers come into play. As you are making a selection of clicks manually, it's important to realize that spectrogram might be helpful for finding approximate locations of the clicks, but because of the time blur, spectrogram might not be the most precise tool for selecting those clicks in time. You can see that this click is getting blurred in time on the spectrogram, but if you actually switch to the waveform view, you might be able to select it much more precisely and do a more localized repair, which will be good for sound quality. So waveform is important for selecting clicks precisely in time if you are doing manual repair.
And locating them. Great. You know, I'm going to take a quick detour. When we were talking about, you were mentioning this idea of automated interpolating or de-clicking, de-crackling, as we come to know it. And there's a part of me that gets very excited
because I remember that 25 years ago to declick something would require about a day and a half. You know, you would take 5 minutes of audio, hit go on the computer, and then leave and come back the next day and hope everything went okay. It would take an enormous amount of time to churn through the numbers. And now we can, you know, work through a minute's worth of material in a minute or something like that. I guess my question is, thinking about computer hardware and performance and so on, is there what aspect of a computer system's performance will influence the speed of the computations that RX is doing? Is it more about processor speed? Is it number of cores? Is it? I'm just curious.
For RX application, it's both number of cores and processor speed. For plugins, it's probably more the processor speed, mm-hmm. the memory speed, the processor speed. Yeah, that's what matters most. Mm-hmm. And as computers get faster and faster, RX algorithms are getting more complex over time. The recent version of RX6 includes machine learning algorithms that crunch millions and millions of numbers to compute a single FFT frame of the audio signal. That's only possible in modern, faster computers. And even in RX6, those machine learning-aided modules do not actually preview in real time for this reason.
There is no real time.
No real-time preview, right?
All right. So anyway, back to what we were talking about. So we've got these broadband denoisers, and we've got interpolators, and actually bringing in this idea of letting the machine, if you will, detect transient sounds and do automated declicking leads me to want to think a little bit about order of processing. Are there things... So some of my assumptions are the more distinct a transient shape is, the easier it will be to perform to identify the problem and then maybe to perform the repair.
You're right. Usually when starting repair, we're trying to begin with operations that could repair impulse noises that only affect a small fraction of waveform samples, as opposed to stationary noises or longer disturbances like maybe footsteps or coughing or rustle of the lav mic. Those kinds of problems usually go last in my workflow. It's subject to debate, but things like clipping repair and clicks usually go first. Mm-hmm. Actually, interestingly, in first versions of RX, we ordered our modules in the list by suggested order of operation. But now, as we have a few dozens of modules, it's not possible to order them anymore because some of them could be easily switched mm-hmm. in order. But declicker and declipper are the first modules I reach for when getting some audio. Mm-hmm. And the reason here being that those kinds of distortions only affect a small fraction of the file samples. And if you repair them, it doesn't prevent the following operations from running smoothly. But if you run a thing like broadband denoiser first, then it might not have enough knowledge that those clicks are clicks, and it will leave them together with some clouds of not suppressed noise around those clicks, because every broadband denoiser works as a multiband gate or an FFT-based gate, and it has some finite time precision, so it doesn't really effectively reduce noise around those very quick impulses or transients. And in this case, when you later want to reduce clicks, the declicker will have trouble localizing the boundaries of those clicks because there are some clouds of noise around them. In RX documentation, there is a flow chart, the suggested order of operations, and the problems that could be solved with different modules. We have it here on the screen. You can see that clipping is the first thing that you would want to get rid of. The problems here are on the left, and suggested solutions or modules that could be used are on the right. From it, you can see, for example, that for clipping, you would first reach for the clip module, but it may not work very well for some kinds of clipping. And the value of this flow chart is that it gives you alternative ways of repairing different problems. Like, for example, if declip didn't work well, you can run de-crackle with certain settings like higher than zero amplitude skew, or you could run deconstruct or spectrally pair, and I will show those alternative ways to solve a problem in the second part of this transmission, where I will give a primer of restoration of a vinyl sample.
Fantastic.
But after clipping, I usually deal with clicks or crackle. And again, de-click is the most obvious module here, but it could be followed by others like interpolate, manual interpolate, or spectrally pair for follow-up.
So I want to just interrupt you for a moment here. First of all, just to reiterate that this flowchart is something that's available to people on the iZotope site. So just so you know, it's there for you as a resource. Could you say a little bit more to us about, you'd mentioned that the declipper wouldn't work for all sorts of clipping, which begs the question, so what kinds of clipping are you talking about? So let's just break that down a little bit more.
Yep. Declipper is pretty specific. It looks for rounded off waveform tops, and not every kind of clipping is like that. There could be some distortion that's technically not clipping, but maybe just a worn vinyl record, and it doesn't necessarily happen at highest signal amplitudes. Let me show you a couple of example waveforms here. One is clipped piano. As you look in the waveform, you can actually see those brick wall shape waveform tops here. And it could be anything. It could be clipping, or it could be brick wall limiting, because brick wall limiting would produce a similar waveform. And until you zoom and actually inspect the waveform at the closed zoom level, you cannot tell whether it's clipping or not. But here you can see those squared off waveform tops. Mm-hmm. And you can probably say it's clipping. And if you look at the spectrogram, you can actually see a little bit of distortion happening to the mostly tonal piano recording. Let's hear it. So now we know it's clipping, and we can confirm it by looking at the waveform. But some kinds of distortion look different. If we listen to this record, that's a vinyl record. Again, the louder sections here sound distorted, but is it really clipping? It's not. If we zoom in on the waveform here, you can see that the waveform samples are actually not squared away at the top. Mm-hmm. So declipper on this record probably wouldn't help. And there is also a good rule of thumb. If you open the declipper module on a sample, it will show you the histogram of waveform samples. If this histogram has peaks at highest levels, like those, that it's a good indication that there is clipping going on, and you want to set the threshold just below the clipping point when you repair. And after that, you're ready to run the declipper. You can see how it reconstructs those clipped samples. But on the other sample, if we compute the histogram, you can see that there is no peak in waveform levels. And so it's unclear where to set the threshold. And it's exactly because there is no clipping here, although there is distortion. Mm-hmm. And I will show you how to get rid of that kind of distortion, but declipper will not really be affected.
So if you were to run a declicker on the piano sample, where the declipper works, why not use a declicking algorithm to remove that kind of clipping distortion? In what way are those signals the same, and in what way are they different?
Clicks are, I would say, more generic. Clipping could be considered as clicks, but clipping is more like a distortion, and it happens in series and bursts, which are not exactly standalone clicks. In restoration, it's very important to be able to precisely separate, first in your mind and then inside the algorithm, the noise or the problem from the clean signal. And with declipper, the advice here is very specific. Distinction is very specific. It's the level of the waveform, of the waveform samples. When the waveform samples are above the clipping threshold, it's bad. When they're below, they're good. And so you can very precisely identify boundaries of signal that has to be repaired. Mm-hmm. In declicker, you have to make guesses whether a certain vertical line on the spectrogram is a transient, an attack of the piano or a drum, or it's an undesirable click. And the clicker will probably do some improvement, but because it is not as precise with classifying signals into good and bad signals, the job it does will not be as good as the clipper. It's all about being able to tell apart where is the good and where is the bad signal in the algorithm. The tools have to be precise.
Yeah, right. And yet we're starting to point at this idea that there's no one way to address a particular problem, that there are sort of, there's some overlap in the way that transient clicks and clipping distortion portray themselves, or, you know, what they're made up of.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. So one of the things that's interesting to me is that when we design tools for people, sometimes we'll design a tool that points at a very specific kind of use, you know, remove Frederica, you know, that module. Well, that's designed to get Frederica out of the recording or out of your room or something like that. But maybe there's similarities between Frederica and Wilhelmina, for instance. So, you know, so as I look at the kinds of tools that we provide people in RX, there are several that present as having similar functions. And it might be interesting to help people in their thinking decide which is better to use for different instances. When is it better to address Frederica? I don't know why I picked those names. But anyway, so you had some specific pairings of modules that you wanted to talk us through.
Yeah. Again, this kind of choice, which module to use, oftentimes comes as a trial and error, but it's important to understand what is each module targeting. Mm-hmm. And the better you can try to separate noise from the signal, the better your result will be. Let's consider the first pair, de-click and de-crackle. De-click module is created for taking away isolated clicks that are relatively strong, but they don't merge together too much, so they're not too dense in time. While de-crackle module is created to treat the continuous crackle or clicks that are coming so often that they could merge in time and create a sandy quality to your audio signal. And oftentimes the click goes first and takes out the most prominent clicks, and then it's followed by a passive de-crackle to take care of smaller clicks that merge together and create a noisy, sandy-like quality. That's one pair. And another one, for example, denoise versus deconstruct. Deconstruct is a module that analyzes the signals based on their spectral shape. It tries to identify tonal components in the signal and separate it from noisy components, but unlike denoise, it doesn't care about levels. What denoise cares about is levels and only levels. It splits the signal into multiple frequency bands and sets the noise threshold in each of those bands as a noise profile. Whenever the signal is below the threshold, it's reduced. Whenever it's above the threshold, it's passed. But deconstruct, on the other hand, separates noisy signals from tonal signals without any regard to level. For example, if you have speech with sibilants and vocalized sounds, it will consider all the sibilants as noise and vocalized sounds as tonal components, and it can separate by that dimension. So knowing what is the desirable signal and what is the undesirable signal is important when choosing whether to use deconstruct and or denoise. And I will show an example of that in a few minutes. But another pair that I'm often asked about is deconstruct versus the new, or denoise versus new voice isolate module in RX6.
Before we get that, I want to go back one step. So you had mentioned at one point the difference between using a denoise module and a dehum tool. Is
yes.
there? Yeah, I mean, clearly there's a difference in the sense that the denoiser module is capable of addressing broadband signals as opposed to deploying a bunch of notch filters. Mm-hmm. Is there any reason to use a dehum tool as opposed to using a denoiser?
Dehum is probably easier to set up. You just type in a hum frequency and you're done. You create a series of notch filters with multiples of this frequency and they work. But I would say that in many cases, denoiser works more carefully. When frequencies of hum overlap with desirable signal, any kind of filtering with notch filters creates distortion in the signal itself, because every filter rings, and the narrower is your notch in hum removal tool, the more ringing it creates. It's the inevitable consequence of time frequency resolution or principle of uncertainty. The narrower filtering, the more precise filter the filter is in frequency, the less precise it's in time. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Yeah, that's helpful. I mean, I often find a denoising strategy or using a denoiser works better than using a bunch of filters. I'm not a big fan of notch filters myself. Yeah. So
I would say that whenever the harmonics of hum overlap with the useful signal, and especially if the useful signal has some kind of transient components in it, you should probably be reaching for a denoiser, because denoiser gates can open and close based on the level of the signal, not only based on frequency like the filter does. Mm-hmm. The hum removal works over frequency without any regard to the level of the signal. The denoiser works in frequency, but also based on the level of the signal. When the signal level goes above the expected level of the hum harmonic at that frequency, the gate opens and lets the signal through. When there is only hum at that frequency, we're removing it with denoiser. And also with denoiser, there is actually a component of it that can only get rid of tunnel noises. In our spectral denoise, you can unlink the reduction or threshold sliders, and then you can only decrease tonal components of noise without touching the noisy or the broadband components of noise, which is helpful for hum removal if you don't want to touch your broadband component of noise.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay. So I interrupted you. You were moving into talking about the difference between...
voice isolate and denoise.
Yeah.
Voice isolate is a new module based on machine learning that is actually created to get rid of non-stationary noises, like footsteps or other kinds of disturbances that the regular denoiser that only works with stationary noises doesn't really tackle. If your noise is stationary, you might have better luck using a regular spectral or voice denoiser. Mm-hmm. But if the noise changes, you should probably reach for voice isolate. The voice isolate module works with a similar principle of spectral attenuation. This is the bunch of gates, hundreds or even thousands of gates that can open and close based on the signal level. But the level at which they close or open is very signal dependent. We analyze the shape of the signal on the spectrogram and try to find speech shapes characteristic to speech. And this is where machine learning helps us. It's very hard to find heuristics that actually tell us whether something looks like speech on the spectrogram or it looks like noise. And machine learning algorithms can help us control those gates more precisely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems, I mean, zoomed way out, it's the difference between trying to pull noise out of a signal as opposed to finding the signal and extracting the signal from the noise. So it's a,
yep.
It gives us a new way of maybe approaching the issue, which stimulates all kinds of questions about, well, then could we demix a recording, you know, ultimately by trying to identify separate signals. I guess this is something that we've been trying. We as an iZotope, we as in, you know, audio people who make audio tools. Actually, anybody who wanted to make a karaoke box, you know, we've wanted it for decades. So
there are some tools in RX6 that can help you with karaoke pursuit. One is called Standard Channel Extractor, and another one is called Deep Lead. So, for example, if you have the a cappella, you can easily subtract it from the mixed recording and just get the instrumental.
Uh-huh. So we should have just called that module Karaoke Machine.
It has more applications than that.
Okay. Fair enough. Great. So before we move on, you've prepared at least one kind of demo, one example that you wanted to walk folks through. Is there anything else that we haven't sort of touched on here that you wanted to make sure that we talked about today?
Actually, no, I think we're good. We can go to the primer of vinyl restoration.
All right, fantastic. So great, and that frames it out. So one of the things, so Alexey has given this demo in front of me before, and what I find fascinating about it is not obviously only your facility with using some of the restoration and denoising tools, but how your thinking about the nature of the signals allows you to do a better job in reducing noise and restoration. And it doesn't just rely on denoising. It's more about strategic thinking. So without further ado, what's the subject here?
Today we will be trying to repair a vinyl record that's pretty old and worn, but as far as I'm aware, there is no existing high-quality master of this record because it's really old. I think it's from 1920s. An old Russian tango song. Let's hear it. So you can hear a lot of crackle, a lot of vinyl clicks, and some distortion as well because the record is really worn. First of all, let's see what we can do with this distortion, whether it's clipping or not. If you zoom into the waveform on the loudest parts, you can see that there is no squared tops, so the declipper module will not really help us, and we can confirm it by checking the histogram of waveform levels here. You can see that there is no real spike in waveform levels around the clipping point here, so there is no clipping. And we will have to deal with this distortion using different means. But as usual, I begin repairing this record, this kind of records, from running the declicker and taking out all the impulse noises. And for that, I'm switching to the spectrogram view and instantiating the declick module. Here I'm choosing the multiband random clicks algorithm. There are a few. Single band algorithm is often used for digital clicks or discontinuities in the waveform, but multiband algorithms are more helpful for clicks that are like vinyl clicks that can only affect a certain frequency range or can exist with different strength at different frequency ranges or just are more diverse. Mm-hmm. Here I'm choosing the random clicks algorithm because the clicks in the vinyl record are random and they're not coming in bursts with a certain pitch. Mm-hmm. And I will be setting sensitivity a little bit higher in this record to 5 or 6 because there is a lot of clicks and a lot of distortion. As I often do with declicker, I run a couple of passes of declicker on the record because a single pass of declicker might take out some of the more prominent clicks and then some of the clicks that could not be heard or discovered by the first pass because they were kind of buried in between louder clicks could be uncovered and become more prominent. So
is that something that's always true with restoration work, is that you've got the noise that presents itself most obviously, usually based on amplitude, but once you take that away, you have the noises that were slightly masked or obscured that now present themselves as the loudest, and you can end up chasing noise forever because, you know, there's always something new that's revealed.
Yeah, it kind of depends on how the noise is layered, whether there are multiple layers of noise of different intensity in the signal. For example, with the denoiser module, you often are just fine with a single pass. But if you do a couple of passes of denoiser, you'll probably find that the noise reduction is becoming more effective in pauses between the sentences of speech or in pauses between songs in quieter parts. But noise kind of comes back during the louder parts of the signal. So this is called noise modulation by the signal. And sometimes noise modulation is preferable to artifacts of deeper noise reduction if you do a deeper pass of noise reduction, just as one pass as opposed to two
figuring
passes.
Figuring out how far to go.
Yeah. Yep. You always have to balance the amount of noise reduction versus the naturalness of timbre, naturalness of tone of the original record. And check yourself whether you're going too far or not with this. That's a tough balance to strike, but sometimes two passes gives you better results. It's always determined by ear. I find myself using a couple of passes of declicker pretty typically, yeah.
Uh-huh, great. So, okay, so you...
Let's check the result.
Yeah.
As you can hear, most of the clicks are gone, but there is still a little bit of that sandy quality. The noise floor is not completely uniform here, and obviously all the distortion is still there. The clicker doesn't really help much with distortion. So let's try to follow up a passive de-clicker with de-crackle. De-crackle, it's almost a no-brainer for me after a de-click. It takes care of those clicks that come more densely in time and always kind of blend together to create the sandy quality of the result. Again, I will probably use a couple of passes of de-crackle similarly to de-clicker. And now I think our noise floor is a little bit more uniform and we are ready to apply noise reduction tools. Obviously, all the distortion is still there, and that's the problem. Many times when you are looking into the best tool to choose for noise reduction, you have to understand what the record is, whether it's mono or stereo, what kind of noise is there. In this record, I could easily hear that the record is either mono or very close to mono. There is very little useful stereo information, but actually the noise is mostly stereo. If you look at the spectrum analyzer as it runs, you can see that the frequency components in lower and middle frequencies are close, but the noise at higher frequencies is kind of more random and has more variation. That's why what I do in such cases is I try to check the record in MS. Mid-side often reveal information about the signal and the noise, such as whether the signal is close to mono, does the noise also happen to be mono, or does it occupy the whole stereo image?
And it's much, even if there was some noise in the correlated signal, it would likely be masked by the signal that's present.
Yeah, there, so. That's right. Oftentimes the noise that's mono is more likely to be masked by the signal. Mm-hmm. Here, it seems to be not the case, but for checking it, I would go to our mixing module and choose the preset called MS encoder. It converts audio signal from left-right representation to MS representation. I hit process and run the whole file through it. What do I see here? Now, the upper channel represents mid and the lower channel represents side. We can listen to them in isolation. This is mid and this is side. You can hear that there is very little useful signal here in the side component, but there is a lot of distortion, which kind of tells us that maybe we should hunt for distortion in the side channel more than the mid channel. One thing to note here is that we also want to make sure that the useful signal is panned strictly to the center, which may not always be the case. And for that, I would go to the azimuth module and briefly explain why. To try to level match the signal in the left and right channel before I even do the MS encoding. Here in the azimuth module, we can detect time shifts and level shifts between stereo channels.
And for those that are familiar with tape, this term azimuth comes from describing the relationship between the tape path, the direction of the tape path, and the angle of the gaps in a headstack. And if they're absolutely aligned, if it was possible to have them absolutely aligned, you would end up with absolute correlation, the same signal arriving at the same time in each gap in the headstack. But invariably, there would be some small rotation one way or another, and that would mean that you would have an azimuth problem, and you wouldn't get quite as clear a center image or correlated or mono signal.
Yeah, and any delay between left and right channels lead to drop in high frequencies when you are mixing it down to mono, and you are getting those high frequencies in the side channel instead, which may not be desirable for best separation of signal from distortion. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So in this case, we just hit the suggest button, and it figures out the delay, which is only a fraction of a sample here, and the gain mismatch, which is more important to us, automatically. Mm-hmm. And we can hit process, and it will adjust the gains of channels. You can see how the waveform changes as you do that. It basically brings right channel up
great.
About a decibel.
Yeah.
Now both channels are aligned in time and have the same gain. Let's do the MS encoder again and see how the result changes. Now you can see that there is even less of the useful signal in the side channel, but all the distortion is still there.
Amazing how much of a difference that made.
Now that we know that the useful signal is in the center or in the mid channel, we can use that knowledge. You can hear it's still distorted, and the reason is that the MS encoder doesn't really isolate the mid channel from the side channels very well. The side channels are somewhat reduced, but only by maybe 3 or 6 decibels, depending on the signal. In RX, we have a better tool for separating mid from side, and it's called the center channel extractor. I'm going to show you that it's more selective than just mid-side encoding. I will go one step back to left and right, but azimuth adjusted left and right. And now in the center channel extractor, I will choose the mode for keeping center channel and attenuating all the side channel. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. As we process it, you can see that much of the noise is gone. And the reason was that noise was spread over the stereo image while the useful signal has been pretty much dead center now after our azimuth adjustment. And I've used this module as opposed to, for example, denoiser, because I think that in this case, the stereo panning angle is what actually provides better separation of useful signal from noise rather than level separation. We can combine multiple tools in RX, and we can, for example, run denoiser as another pass here, but it's always important to realize that in many cases, signals do not differ from noise just by levels. It could be by stereo angle or by shape of the spectrum, and depending on that, you would either use denoiser or center channel extractor or deconstruct if it's the spectral shape or voice isolate if your desirable signal is voice for more effective noise removal. Mm-hmm. Let's hear the result. You can hear that much of the distortion is gone, and the reason is that it mostly existed across the stereo spectrum, stereo panning angles, while the signal was pretty much centered. Mm-hmm. So center channel extractor was very effective here for reducing distortion. It didn't go all the way because some of the distortion also existed at the same stereo angle as mm-hmm. the signal. Mm-hmm. And we will try to follow up this center extract with some other modules that could also be used for reducing distortion. One of them is deconstruct. Another one is called de-crackle. We've already used it, but now what I will do here is I will use the time frequency selection to select areas that are most offending. Let me play it. That's, I think, where most of the distortion mm-hmm. can be heard. And it's easy to confirm on the spectrogram. So what I will do is I will run another pass of de-crackle in a slightly different mode here and with higher strength. It's okay to slightly damage the signal in just this narrow frequency range.
Damage is a word you never use in front of a client, I'd like to say.
That's right. But I will still run a small pass of de-crackle with higher strength here to get rid of that sandy quality of this distortion. And now one more process that I like to use in such a case is deconstruct. Deconstruct can separate distortion products from harmonics of the noise or musical instruments here just by looking at the spectral shape. You can see some wavy lines here which denote vibrato of the voice, mm-hmm. and some horizontal lines which reflect the harmonics of the instruments accompanying the voice here. And you can also see some clouds of noise here and there. The noise, it's not stationary. You can see that it's kind of changing in level. Here it's louder, here it's quieter. So deconstruct would be a useful tool here because it pays no attention to the level of noise, but it pays attention to the shape of noise on the spectrum. And I will show you what it could do at the extreme by just killing all the noisy components here. You can see that it kind of remembers this harmonic, but attenuates many others. I will not go so far, so I will use maybe -4 decibels of noise reduction and check the spectrogram and the waveform. I think it's better. What I could do here, I could go an extra mile and only do maybe a couple of decibels in left channel and a stronger processing in the right channel. Here, maybe 4 decibels. Actually, maybe 6 decibels would be fine here. Oh,
you're increasing
added.
The fee. Yes.
Did I also increase it in the right channel?
I think you may have.
All right. I'm going to back a couple of steps. So -2 in the left channel.
Yeah. Yeah.
And -6.
It's interesting, as you're doing that, I when you did both channels together, it was easier to see, to visually see the change in the noise floor. And when you're doing it independently in each, just...
The noise floor becomes more uniform.
Yes, that's right.
And that's my
right.
goal. This noise floor is actually the product of distortion, and I want them to blend with the surrounding noise floor. Mm-hmm. And that's why oftentimes in left and right channels, you need slightly different amount of treatment. It's very close to good result. I would slightly process this section as well, maybe -3 decibels.
And here we run the risk of, I mean, we could sit here for a long time,
right,
chasing every little bit, but at some point Matt would run out of hard disk space, so.
One small stroke here. Let's hear the result. I think it's pretty close. Now, one more thing that I suggest, if you still have more variation of the noise floor than you like, is you could use spectral repair to repair the rest. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Just making such a selection and using attenuate mode and spectral repair with maybe a lower strength than 1. Like 0.3 would make this noise floor a little bit more uniform. And same thing here. You can see as I go back and forth in the undo history that it becomes a little bit more uniform. Let's check if it still sounds natural.
Yep.
I think it sounds good enough to me. One more thing that I would like to show here is that you can often complement one process with the other. For example, if you have reduced noise with deconstruct or center channel extractor, it doesn't prevent you from running a denoiser. One complexity with running a denoiser on this sample is that we don't have a section of pure noise to sample it from.
Uh-huh.
It kind of cuts off abruptly. What we can do in such cases is we can sample the noise floor from discontinuous selections that we manually make.
Yeah, this is fascinating to see. Yep.
In the file. If you sample the noise from a quiet section of the file, you will see that in the noise profile there is a lot of harmonics of the voice and instruments, and this is undesirable because all of them will be reduced if you run the denoiser. But what we will do here is we will make more accurate selections so that only noise gets into the selection, and then we train the denoiser from those selections. Mm-hmm. Most of those high frequencies are pure noise. So we have sampled noise at higher frequencies. We will sample noise at higher frequencies. But what about lower frequencies? The denoiser needs to know the noise profile at most of the frequencies to be successful. So we will make very localized selections here between harmonics and let the denoiser train on those smaller selections. We can go as granularly as we want here. We have to be careful to not allow any harmonics mm-hmm. into the noise profile.
So some of the information that we're seeing there, is there a risk that any of that is low-level harmonic?
Could be.
Yeah.
Yeah. We will be careful with the amount of noise reduction that we apply here.
Yeah.
And something at lower frequencies. Mm-hmm. You can see as I'm zooming into frequency, I'm getting more frequency precision thanks to the auto-adjustable spectrogram. And now I think we are ready to train denoiser on those selections. We just hit the learn button. And you can see that the denoiser has sampled the noise profile at those frequencies, but it didn't sample at other frequencies. And it offers us to complete the noise profile at those frequencies by smoothly connecting those pieces into a noise profile that covers all the frequency range. Mm-hmm. Now I think it's ready to run the noise reduction. I typically run the default settings and just set the quality to best mm-hmm. here. I may back off the reduction a little bit.
Sure.
Because we have already applied a passive standard channel extractor that was effectively a denoiser in this situation. So I might use minus 6 dB because the noise floor is variable in this recording. It's not completely constant because it's vinyl. I will use the threshold of plus 3 or plus 2 decibels. It would allow all the noise as it varies be mostly below the noise threshold. And once I've done that, I hit process. You can see that the spectrogram, mostly at high frequencies, is getting darker. It means that the denoiser has worked. Let's hear the result. Most of the noise is gone. Most of the distortion is gone. Now, because we know that this record is mono, I think a good last step would be to just downmix it to mono. And that can, again, be done in our mixing module. Mix to mono preset, and run process on it. Now, if we listen to the result, it is indeed mono, and much of the distortion is gone. I think we are getting about 3 decibels of extra attenuation of distortion just by downmixing to mono in this case. Mm-hmm. If we know that the record is mono, that's...
Is there a disadvantage to doing that? I mean, when you take whatever small differences between the signals exist, at least in my experience, there's this sort of perception that you've lost a little bit of...
Space.
Yeah, I guess that's the best word for it. You could call it depth. You could, you know, there. Obviously, when you're listening through two ears, mm-hmm. which we are, you know, there's a difference. It's a little more diffuse. It's a little wider. It's a little bigger.
It's often useful to have a little bit of residual noise that's stereo, just to give the impression that maybe one time it was a stereo record.
Right. Right. So we've taken out all the noise, so we can put some back in.
We have taken out all the noise, and that's actually a good point. If you listen to this record, it sounds pretty clean, I would say, and distortion-free, but maybe not as authentic. And what I often do in this case, I go back, all the way back in the undo history, to the original state, and I copy by pressing Command-C mm-hmm. to the new file.
A challenge to do that on a Mac, isn't it?
I copy the original file to the new file, and I reduce the gain by maybe minus 30 dB or minus 20 dB. I'll do 25 in this case, just as an example. I will copy it again, and I will put it back into this file after all the processing is done by mixing the results. Shift-V is the keyboard shortcut.
Command-V.
Yeah, so you can see a little bit of noise returning in this file.
Oh, there you go.
Let's listen. Yeah. And of course, a little bit of distortion is getting back as well. But by maybe doing minus 30 dB instead of minus 25, you would be able to strike a good balance between that, a little bit of authentic residual noisy sound, noisy quality of a vinyl record, as opposed to a slightly maybe washy result of restoration that takes all the noise out of the record.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, you know, when we listen to something that involves noise, our brain, while we can train our perception on the noise or the musical signal separately, they really are one thing. And when the noise goes away, there's a frequency-based component that I think that we miss. You know, you can interpret the disappearance of the noise as, you know, wow, I've lost all the top end in my recording, when in fact all you've done is taken the noise out. So sometimes leaving a little bit of it in.
Yep. That's right. Equalization is another process that often helps after noise reduction. Boosting those high frequencies a little bit might help compensating the impression that there is no more high frequencies in this record.
Yeah. Or in this case, I might even add just a tiny bit of smooth ambience back behind it. Not something detectable from the original signal, but maybe to restore that sense of depth back behind. So
that's a good idea.
Yeah, great. Well, this is fascinating. I think a lot of the thinking that you're doing in front of people is transferable to lots of different kinds of work. It's very interesting to watch you work and think about it, and I appreciate you doing it.
Let's compare the result once again with the original state of this file.
That's kind of amazing. When was this recorded? What year was this?
I think it was 1920s.
Yeah. Wow. 100 years ago. And we can still hear it. That's also amazing. More magic. Great. Well, thank you so much, Alexey. I appreciate you joining
me.
And we'll look forward to getting your comments and feedback about this. Please fill out the survey and keep sending in questions. We also have an email address, headroom@iZotope.com, where you can also send questions in by that form once this ends. And thanks for joining us. Stay tuned for the next episode of Headroom. I'm not going to tell you what it is yet. We'll see you then.
something else to write about again.